This conference will now be recorded.
Good evening, everyone. I am glad to welcome Dr. Ashiba, head of the department, CSE, who have been a great support to initiate this webinar. And I welcome our organizers, Mr. Sampat Kumar, Assistant Professor CSE, Ms. Gayatri, Assistant Professor CSE, and all other faculty members. And now I welcome our presenters and our student friends and all other attendees who have joined us to enlighten this session. Once again, good evening all. Now I affably invite Mrs. Gayatri, Assistant Professor CSE, to initiate this session.
Thank you, Shanya. Good evening all. Am I audible? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Good evening all. On behalf of our Department of Computer Science and Engineering, I welcome you all for the today's session, Day 2 Students Webinar Series. Yesterday, on June 8, we inaugurated our webinar series with a kickstart one on the topic on emerging technology, that is machine learning. And today, we have another distributed ledger technology called blockchain, where it says how the transactions or the records are handled efficiently in our day-to-day business life. I take this opportunity to introduce our student Vishal of 2nd CSEC to start a mind-blowing session on blockchain technology. Before we would like to hear from Vishal, I once again thank you for accepting our invitation and let us motivate our students to grow more in their skill levels during their career. Thank you. Now I call upon Vishal to start your session.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Sharmila, for introducing me. Ma'am, am I audible, ma'am?
Vishal, you are audible, Vishal.
Sampat.
Ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
Vishal.
Yes, ma'am.
I want to take 2 minutes time.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Sorry for that interruption. Why only 16 participants are there? What about others? I think only 17 people
are there. My mothers are joining, ma'am.
Okay. So maybe you can wait for 2 more minutes because if they join late, they won't be able to get the content, right? So just
sure,
2 minutes you can wait. How many participants you're expecting?
No, around 50 to 70, ma'am.
How many were there yesterday?
90, ma'am. Around 90 people were there, ma'am.
Around 90 people. So I think we can wait for just 2 minutes. We can wait. Maybe by that time, Vishal, you can say how you got your interest in blockchain technology, how you developed interest towards blockchain technology, so others, they can also identify their domains of interest, they can work on that. So by the time other people will also join, so we can start and it will be useful for everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Is it okay, Vishal?
Yes, ma'am. I'll wait for 2 minutes.
Yeah, you can wait for 2 minutes, but by the time what you can do is, because there are so many technologies available and you have chosen blockchain technology, right? And definitely you would have got some interest in blockchain technology and you have developed some skill in blockchain and technology, right? So how you developed that, you can share your experience with your friends.
Okay, ma'am. It all started when everyone next to the screen, the Bitcoin lured me into this technology, but not stopping with that excitement, I also learned about the technology more. And when I started learning about the technology, I started seeing the potential of the technology being more than a digital currency. Like the level of integrity that technology could give to our IT sector is enormous. So after that, it was was highly fascinated to work on some real-time projects on blockchain. So once we learn something theoretically, it's different. And once we start doing something practically, it's totally different. So during the beginning stages, I was able to visualize and ideally think how we can transform something into an idea of blockchain. But started working, it didn't work out that well. But still, I had done two projects in blockchain, and I see more potential in blockchain. And this is what I have seen now.
Okay, good. I think some people have joined now.
Okay, ma'am.
Yes. Yeah, some people have joined. I think we'll start the session. Okay. So actually, so for everybody's information, we are starting this. Actually, we have started this student webinar series from yesterday. Yesterday, I wanted to join, but due to some official commitment, I could not join yesterday. So today, yesterday, the inauguration was there. And today, we are having the second day of this webinar series. And today's session will be handled by Vishal. And if I am right, I think he is the only one and only second year student who is giving this webinar. I think all others, they are from the higher semesters. So let us appreciate Vishal for his interest and his effort, and definitely he must be knowledgeable in this field, and that is why he is willing to come forward for this session. And so many student seminars we have conducted before, but I think this is definitely different. For the first time, we are conducting it as a series. And previously, whenever we used to conduct seminars, what we actually do is that particular student will be giving a seminar only to his classmates. So the audience will be limited to one particular class. Or else what we'll do is, like what we used to do is, one senior student will be giving will be addressing the junior class members. That is how it is used to be. But because of this lockdown, though lockdown has suppressed us in so many fronts, I think it has opened so many opportunities also. I think this is one opportunity. Through online, they're able to address everybody. So one student, he can address a second year, third year, final year. I think even students from other colleges are also attending. That is what the information I got. So across the world, anybody you can address due to this particular technology. So this is a really something different what we have not ventured so far, something different we are trying out this time. And we want to give this opportunity to everybody. So we know that every single student of our department, of our institution, they are knowledgeable in one or other field. So we want your knowledge to be shared with others, knowledge to be exchanged with others, and so that the process of learning will happen continuously. But when we throw out this opportunity, only few students have taken this opportunity. Only few students came forward. Initially, they gave their names. Then we asked them to prepare a small video, a short duration video for 2 to 3 minutes, and they gave it. And we were not able to reject even a single video. All the videos were of very high quality. What we actually looked for is, actually we wanted all the videos to be content rich, and every single video was content rich. Everybody, every single student who opted to give seminar, he or she was very strong in his concepts, and which we really admired. So that is the reason we didn't reject even a single student. So everybody were given the opportunity. What I would request you is, you take this as an opportunity. Those who are the attendees of this seminar, you take this as an opportunity. Definitely you will be also knowing, you will be having some in-depth knowledge in one particular technology, especially final year students. Definitely will have some exposure to a particular technology, and you can share that with your fellow mates. So this is one opportunity. So this is the first series. Again, we are planning for second series, third series, etc. So if at all people are willing, definitely we can plan for infinite series. We don't have any problem at all. So if at all you are willing, maybe end of this week, again, we'll give a circular regarding this. So those who are willing to take up the seminar, you can give your names. So this is one thing which I wanted to say. And One more point which I wanted to make today is, like when Vishal was saying how he got interest into this particular field, he was saying that initially he was fascinated by the idea, then he had some setbacks. Then one particular point which he mentioned was theoretical knowledge will not be sufficient. Only when he started to do projects in this area, he was confident enough to give a presentation. So this is what everybody, you all should have in mind. So curriculum, learning subjects in the curriculum, courses in the curriculum, doing lab, doing programs in the lab alone is not sufficient. Everybody is expected to learn one technology in depth, and that technology should be, it should be over and above the syllabus. So identify the technology. Initially, it will be difficult. You may have also need to face setbacks like Vishal. Then engage yourself practically into the technology. So many forums are available. I think I need not mention about all the forums available today. Everything is available in the internet. So even if you want to do some projects, you will get some use cases in the internet. You will help on, you will get online guidance, online help, support, everything. Even evaluation, online evaluation is available. So make use of all those things, especially during this lockdown period. You have enormous amount of time. Make use of the time. And get yourself associated with any one technology. Be very strong in the technology and try to present your ideas to others, so you will gain more confidence and also it will be useful for others. So with this, I welcome Vishal to give this particular webinar on blockchain technology. Blockchain, definitely it is a very thrust, a very important thrust area in computer science. I'm happy that Vishal is giving a seminar on this particular area. Hope this will be useful for all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for that brief introduction. Good afternoon, respected HOD and faculty members and students who have joined this webinar. And I'm super excited in welcoming you all for this webinar on blockchain. So let me introduce myself to you all. I am Vishal from second year computer science department. To tell more about my technical qualifications to take this webinar, I have been learning blockchain technology for nearly a year, and I have worked on two real-time projects in blockchain. Since my search about what is blockchain, I have been fascinated by knowing the potential of this technology. I'm here to break down the buzz or the hype over this technology in transforming today's authenticity, privacy, economy, and business into next level in the upcoming future. So guys, stay with me till the end to know blockchain. So let's start with the question, what is blockchain? So we all know what a linked list is in data structure. A linked list consists of number of nodes connected with pointers. They are memory addresses. Likewise, blockchain is a distributed data structure that is being replicated in different hierarchy of peers and linked cryptographically. That is, every other block is linked cryptographically to the previous block. The nodes connected in the system are running distributed algorithm. These distributed algorithm are designed in such a way that they maintain data consistency and integrity. So the main purpose of blockchain is to maintain the integrity of the data. So what do you mean by the word integrity is, once someone who has the authority for the data enters the data into certain fields, the data can never be tampered. It's virtually impossible for someone to tamper a data inside a blockchain. And there are some consensus algorithms. Only when all the nodes in the system accept the transaction, then only the block gets added to the ledger. So knowing well what the blockchain is, let's know how it looks. Okay. So every block in a blockchain, the beginning block is called Genesis block. Only when you create a Genesis block, you can create a blockchain. So a Genesis block contains a data column, and the previous hash of a Genesis block will always be zero. So this hash is generated when you put the data into it and mine it. Once this hash is generated, this block is encrypted. So we are going to create another block, put in our data, and when you see clearly, this block is linked with this block using the hash of this block, that is the previous hash, in this manner. So these two are cryptographically linked, and when we try to create another block, it also has a data, and it gets linked to the previous block with the hash that has been generated for this block, and they are cryptographically linked. So this is a simple intuition of blockchain. With this note, we know blocks are cryptographically linked to each other in a blockchain. With that said, let's have a demo on how a blockchain works. Like, I found something on the internet, like it's a open source contribution by Anders Brownworth, and it's a very good tool to understand how a blockchain really works visually. So here it is. So this is something called SHA-256 hash, and this is an algorithm to convert any data you put into it to a 64-bit hash. So let's see what happens. We are putting a data into it, and you see the hash changing below. So it provides encrypted hash for all the data you put into it. So one second. So let's see what a block is. So as I shown in the previous slide, a block looks like this. This is the first block, that is the genesis block, and we have not talked about what a nonce is. This term minus has to have a bigger concern on this. This is called number used only once. That is, when we mine this block, the number that is used only once during hashing will be returned here. So let's see what happens when we put in a data into it. Data, it can be any kind of data, not only strings. So once we mine it, the hash and the nonce get changed. So this is what a hash is, and let's see how a blockchain looks. Blockchain. So they have made a very good visual representation of blockchain. This consists of 5 blocks. So what happens here is, as I said, every block is cryptographically linked. As you see here, the hash here and the hash here are same. So all the blocks are cryptographically linked, and I will show you by putting in data into all the blocks in the chain and mine it, and how it is tamper proof. That I told about data integrity, right? Let's see that. So for now, we can have data itself. So for now, we have a simple blockchain with some data. So let's mine it. Okay, I will explain about mining in the upcoming slides. So let's mine this blockchain. So now we have mined the blockchain. So what happens is, for all the data we have put into a block, a hash is generated, and all the blocks are cryptographically linked. So let's try to tamper this, but this is virtually impossible. Even if someone cracks into the system and with high level of computation tries to tamper the data, there is some kind of validity algorithm in blockchain that once a data in a block is tampered, all the other preceding blocks get invalid. So we can't have this data for this. As for instance, let's consider we are going to tamper the data in this block. The preceding blocks after this gets invalid. So this is a very basic and simple model of blockchain and how it works. So let's see what a distributed blockchain is. So we have seen one blockchain, but this is a distributed set of blockchain which is being distributed to 3 peers. Peers are the different users in a system, in a network. They have the same copy of the blockchain. When you see this, all the other users will have the same data. Let's consider this, like the hash here ends 677, and here also 677. So even the blockchain had some kind of integrity, this kind of distributed blockchain has another level of integrity that if someone tampers one peer's blockchain, another peer could give their copies and their validity will prove the integrity of blockchain. So let's see what tokens. These tokens are just the same as the distributed, but with some transactions in them. Okay, now let's get back to the presentation. So I hope that demo was quite a good visualization for you to understand how a blockchain works. And let's get to the point, why blockchain? It is a transformative technology that is about to transform various sectors in the near future. Like we all know how the internet came in 1990s and it just transformed the way of communication we had. So when I say blockchain is a transformative technology, I mean it's going to transformate many of the fields in the upcoming future. So e-governance is a very important field in blockchain. E-governance is being application of blockchain due to its level of security and integrity. United Arab Emirates becomes the first blockchain powered government. Various government activities like records of property ownership and licensing are done in blockchain. We will look into it how far India is going to work on it, but we will come into this technology sooner. So supply chain management is one important sector that requires blockchain. This process can achieve quality, integrity and originality over the product using blockchain. Let's consider you're buying a Reebok t-shirt and you know the quality of the t-shirt, but you don't know whether it's original Reebok or not. With supply chain management using blockchain, we can have a check at every single supplier in the supply chain, and we will at the end we can assure the originality of the product. So financial market, this market has a greater scope for blockchain because the stock market, the bond market, everywhere the ledgers are involved. So it's a good market. But as a computer science engineers and as students, we can look more into web technology because web technology's next level has a huge impact of blockchain on it. And we will talk about this in detail in the upcoming slides. So next we are getting into how it got invented. Like this slide explains the pre-invention. Stuart Haber and Scott Stornetta were the first people in the history to coin something related to blockchain. They didn't actually invent blockchain, but they have published a paper called Timestamp of a Digital Document in 1991. But all the concepts in today's blockchain have been derived from their paper. Their paper is the first paper that had the documenting of timestamp. So let's get into invention. So Satoshi Nakamoto, pseudonymous, this is a set of people or individual who refer to them as Satoshi Nakamoto. They are the inventors of blockchain and Bitcoin, because Bitcoin is the first application and it was the first version of blockchain. It was invented in 2009. This is said to be the invention of blockchain technology. During 2009, there was a huge financial crisis due to the central banks printing fiat currencies and liquefy the value of present money, causing deflation. This triggered people to think about digital currencies which have more people-centric values. But this was not the first time when people tried to produce a digital currency, but this was the first time when double spending problem was solved. So I will explain what double spending is. When I have a currency in my hand and I can only spend it and you can't spend the same currency, but when a currency is digital, we can have a copy of it and we can do double spending. If double spending is possible, triple spending is also possible. So it was a big problem, and Bitcoin using blockchain solved this problem by distributed peer-to-peer networks. As I shown before in the demo class, every peers will have the data of the blockchain, and only when the consensus accepts it, the blocks get added to it. So the first generation of blockchain had only the simple ledgers that records the transaction into the blocks, and that had some only few applications, but they were not programmable and we couldn't build more on them. So they were immutable ledgers precisely. They had the high level of data integrity on their first version itself. Every transaction done in one block is being replicated to all the peers in the network. So the next point is proof of work. This proof of work is a concept in which the consensus is arrived. To arrive at consensus, we need the proof of work. That is, all the people in the consensus, all the peers in the consensus should accept a block to be added. So this was a major problem solving algorithm or technique that Satoshi Nakamoto invented and that revolutionized. So let's look more into the first generation of blockchain, the Bitcoin. So Bitcoin is a protocol. You can think Bitcoin like a protocol. Some examples are IP, TCP, HTTP. They are all protocol. Likewise, Bitcoin is also a protocol that rely on blockchain technology. They have their own rules. Every other cryptocurrency in the crypto world is a kind of protocol. They have a coin for themselves, and it is an inert asset of that protocol. For in case of Bitcoin, the Bitcoin is the innate asset of it. The coins help the users to interact. Like, people use these coins for transaction, and miners will record the transactions. So coming to the next point, today we use our currency, we do banking, and there are central banks and banking employees who are working for us. But in cryptocurrency, there are no central banks. It's totally done by the miners. So mining is the process of adding a block into the chain by solving cryptographical puzzles that generate hash for the particular block. Like, if we do certain number of transactions, there will be cryptographical puzzle that the miner needs to solve. Only when he solves it, the blocks gets added to the blockchain. No one does this for free. Every miner earns some amount of coins. During the starting stages of Bitcoin, they awarded 50 Bitcoins initially. Later, it was reduced to 25, and now it's 12.5. But what we did in our demo, the mining was so easy, but it's not the same today. You won't believe me. It requires high level of computational power that all over the world, they are investing on mining rigs, and they are building its own. To give you a better insight about the computation power required, we all know what is a CPU is, and it's a general purpose system. It can process hash up to 10 million hashes per second. And GPUs are somewhat specialized systems. These can process the transactions, hashes, up to 1 giga hashes per second. But these are also not enough for mining a Bitcoin, because one block of Bitcoin needs 21 quadrillion hashes for it to get added to a blockchain. So the electronic engineering groups invented something called ASICs, application specific integrated circuits. They are totally specialized for mining Bitcoins. They process the transaction more than 1,000 hashes per second. So even when we know what the technology is, there is a theoretical possible of how we can attack a blockchain, attack a Bitcoin. That is 51% attack theory, and I will also say about it. We saw about proof of work, that when everyone accepts the consensus, will add, the block will be added. But if someone could gather themselves more than 51% of the computation power in the Bitcoin network, they can have the total control over the network. This has never been done in the history, but this is theoretically possible, and it's not virtually possible. So with that note, with all the hypes, let me ask you a question. Is Bitcoin blockchain? What are the potential of blockchain than just a currency? Like, it doesn't actually mean blockchain stops only the currency at the place of currency. When I introduce you the second generation and third generation of blockchain, you will get to know more about blockchain and its potential. So here we go. Vitalik Buterin entered Ethereum in the year of 2015. Ethereum is known as the silver of crypto world. the invention of Ethereum, the second generation of blockchain comes into play, where we can build decentralized applications over blockchain. Decentralized applications are applications that are built on a blockchain. And with this invention of Ethereum, we can use blockchain database. Being it said, Ethereum is the first programmable blockchain, but it has only one language that it can be programmed. When I say program, you will think about something like, where will I keep the program? So there is something called tokens. Okay. The second generation of blockchain doesn't only rely on the blockchain technology and have a protocol, but it also has something called tokens. So the tokens are something over which you can write your code and instructions. You can write your code and instructions for the computers to run on it. So Ethereum has hundreds of tokens over which you can program. These are some examples of the tokens. So smart contracts. What are smart contracts? Smart contracts are computer programs that return on tokens that computer programs, like whatever the instruction want to give, the smart contracts will work on the blockchain. So it can automatically get executed, control and document according to the terms of the contract and agreement to the negotiations. So you can write application on top of blockchain after the invention of Ethereum, before which we can't have any other sort of data rather than instruction inside a blockchain. This is the first time we had a real-time data to interact within it. With the second generation of blockchain, we had the proof transforming from proof of work to proof of stake. Proof of stake is simply people holding a lot of coins will determine the next block. Like the people, not only a lot of coins, but also there are some other parameters through which they will determine who will determine the next block. According to many many people, this method was energy efficient than Bitcoin's method of proof of work, and it avoids the 51% attack. So let's go. Okay, with that said, Ethereum's first and biggest application on smart contracts was DAOs. They are decentralized autonomous organizations. They are extraordinary institutional technologies that can automate the whole institution. Said that you could transform all your instructions into a code. It gives automated trust, and it increased the frictional value exchange. This gave rise to the institutional evolution on computers. So in DAOs, the rules are coded as contracts. For instance, let's consider a hierarchy of employees in an office, and all the institutional level positions are taken away by computers as decentralized autonomous organizations. Because of the integrity that it provided, they are even ready to give the institutional level to computers. So this was something more self-organizing system by people in the system. Even their reputations were recorded in this DAOs. But with all that benefits, if you go on search on Google that can we hack a blockchain, and you would see the first thing you would see is the DAO getting attacked during 2016. I would like to say a note about it, say something about it. Like, as we know, the proof of stake, that only the majority or the people with the maximum number of coins can decide what happens in a blockchain in Ethereum. The Ethereum community added some functionality for the minorities also, protecting the minorities. Like, if they want to retrieve their funds and if they are not interested to add their funds in the block, they can retrieve it. So this was a minority, this was a function added for the protection of minority. But we all know hackers look into vulnerabilities, and they always try to hack the system by understanding how it works. What they did is vulnerability in this system also, that the retrieving funds function was recursively called, and a lot of money was hacked out of it. it is said that 3.6 million of Ethereum was hacked worth $50 million. After this heist, the Ethereum DAO hard forked the technology and they got back the positions. So with that said, let's go into DApps. Decentralized applications are applications that are totally different from today's applications in their backends. Today we have a centralized server in a cloud and we users use it, but decentralized apps are decentralized that all the users in the network seem to be peers and they all have the servers in their own devices encrypted. So this is called decentralized applications. And this one is very interesting, the ICOs. I see this to be the future of investing in a company. So when we consider investing in a company, today we invest by buying the shares of a company. And if the shares go, if the company gets some profit, we also, our shares rate also increases. But what ICOs are is they are initial coin offerings. These are tokens of a cryptocurrency given to people instead of shares. As the demand of the coin increases, the value of exchange also increases. So ICOs are more like crowdfunding, but their value increases as company progresses. So with that said, we get into third generation of blockchain. So this is the present generation, and this is the latest technology that has been evolved in blockchain. So Dan Larimer invented EOS in the year of 2015. It is a protocol of native crypto EOS, and it is said to be the most powerful infrastructure for DApps. Like from Ethereum transformed from Bitcoin with some abilities, but EOS transformed from Ethereum with so much abilities that its transaction speed was outnumbered Bitcoin and Ethereum. With this said, blockchain even evolves in third generation with EOS. It allows the users to program DApps using various web assembly languages in one language. In Ethereum, we were only allowed to program it with one language called Solidity, but here we can program it with different languages. In Ethereum, when we deploy a project, we can't, it's immutable, but EOS is upgradable and it's bug, we can fix the bug recoveries. This EOS had the highest transaction processing per second of nearly a million, where Ethereum had just 5 transactions per second, just a comparison for you. This technology, this coin had delegated proof of stake. Delegated proof of stake means the users in the system vote for someone who decides which block to be added. They are called block producers. So they vote for the block producer, and the block producer does the job of adding the block. It's more democratic and good when compared to Ethereum and Bitcoin. So with that said, the third generation of blockchain also had lots and lots of evolution into the internet. Like they also had cloud servicing. Like Sia is one remarkable cloud servicing platform in blockchain that in which we can rent a storage, and it's a community based one. You can rent a storage for certain amount of Sia coins, or you can earn Sia coins by giving a part of your unused hardware for renting. So this is the invention and evolution of blockchain. Let's get to know more about how we can work on it to improve our careers. So with all the fields that blockchain can impact, why I have chosen web technology to explain is because we all are interested in developing websites, and we should know where the next level of developing a website goes so that we can put in our ideas into doing some web technology projects using blockchain. So I will give a quick note on how web technology has evolved to blockchain. Web technology 1.0 was a global library, and it had informations arranged in it without any styles, and it was a single database system. And web technology 2.0 was a global publishing system where every individual got an access to create their own information, and it was a global database. And this is the place where the front end developed, and lots of responsive websites were being developed. So we evolved into Web 3.0. Web 3.0 didn't have much changes in its look, but it's totally in its functionalities, that the data becoming a valuable resource is totally dependent on how secure the data is kept. Web 3.0 doesn't change much in UI or front end, but the back end is completely placed on blockchain network. That all the database for this website is placed inside a blockchain network. The cryptocurrencies and blockchain are the foundation of the global data bank. So as I said, this, you would have visualized this technology of Web 3.0 would be coming somewhere after 5 years or 10 years, but that's not true. We have this many applications today at present running on Web 3.0. Every technology in the screen has their own blockchain database. So I would like to add a note on some of the technologies that I have checked. Steemit is a very nice social network, which is almost similar to the Medium blog posting, in which users can post their contents, and for the likes they receive, they can earn Ethereum. So next, Ethlands. This one is really amazing, that this is a remote job application in which you can ask users to do job for you and pay them Ethereum. And you can also do jobs for people who have posted in it and earn Ethereum. So this one is really nice. And this is a messaging platform, something similar to WhatsApp with multitask messaging. This is a peer-to-peer, highly encrypted chatting application that is built on ECHT token and Ethereum. As the last note, I would like to say about Everledger. This Everledger is a global ledger that holds certificates of diamonds. This is a London company. Diamonds totally depend on their certifications for their value. They have put in their efforts in diamond. They are also looking for upgrading it to some other luxury goods. So with that said, let's see which are the high-end companies that are working on blockchain. So these are the companies that are working on blockchain. So let's start with Samsung blockchain. Samsung has already built their own wallet that stores the private keys of their users, and it's a key store application, and you can run so many dApps on the latest Samsung Galaxy phones. And they also give software development kits as application programming interfaces. So they have taken a good lead in blockchain technology. To say about IBM and blockchain, you just go to Google and search blockchain, you will see IBM. They are putting ads for blockchain on Google. That's how serious IBM is on blockchain. So using IBM blockchain, you can build your own solutions for blockchain. Hyperledger is a project of open source project of blockchain and related tools. IBM contributes to this project. Using this Hyperledger, we can build a business to business and business to customer decentralized applications very easily using the fabrics in it. Facebook is also into blockchain. They have developed their own cryptocurrency called Libra, which they want to make it as a global currency that would make international transaction in second, and it's also programmable. With that, we come to the end of our session. Why I've ended the session at by saying this companies and the companies like this are, if you are someone who is looking for a job, you have your reasons to learn blockchain, that these big companies are working, but there are so many other big companies which are working on blockchain that I haven't mentioned here. Or if you are someone who is that much capable of creating one company like this, you would end up creating one like this. Thank you.
That was a wonderful session. Thank you, Vishal. And now it's time for Q&A session. If you have any queries, you can post it up in the chat box. And here is the question, Vishal. The question is from Sampath Kumar, sir. And the question is it safe to invest money in cryptocurrency?
Oh, it's definitely a no, because being said that Bitcoin is highly volatile, and we should understand something like the name is cryptocurrency. Currencies are made for making transactions, and we shouldn't invest in them. Investing in it makes the purpose of it fail, and it's not a good idea to invest in cryptocurrencies. But you can invest in the stocks and shares of the company in the stock market, but not on the currency itself. Because if you invest on the currency, you're accumulating it, and the purpose of it is to do some transaction with it. So it's not really good to invest in cryptocurrencies. It's on your own risk, actually.
Thank you, Vishal.
Okay.
And we have got another question too. The question is from Keithi Vasan. The question is, can you tell us about your projects on blockchain and the stages?
I have done two projects in blockchain. I have also added the slide in here. I will explain about it. Okay. So this was my first project on blockchain. This was really a big project, and we didn't implement the whole project yet, but I'll try to explain this to you. So this was a tender management system, which we tried to automate the whole procurement thing that happens in a tender. So a bidder bids their bid for a company here. We encrypt the bidder's information inside blockchain, that is using this as a database, and they give their technical evaluations and commercial evaluation that whatever they did in the past, like if they are capable of doing the job and the rate that they have bid at, we will evaluate this using smart contracts. So this is automated and the vendor is selected. So there is something called supply contract in procurement process. This contains the rules and regulations that the tender and the person who is getting the tender has to follow. This is also automated using smart contracts. And we also automate, given an idea for automating various procurement process. Unfortunately, this was done for the Gale organization. They didn't accept this, but still I had a good scope of learning all this procurement management systems. So this was our first project.
Thank you, Vishal. And we have got another question too. Like it is, how can we start learning blockchain technology as a beginner? Is there any resource that you would recommend for us?
I will show there are a number of websites that are actually developing their own blockchain company. You could start there, or I had enrolled myself in a course called I'll show that to you also. So can you see this? This is a course by IIT Kanpur, Introduction to Blockchain Technology and its Application. This resource is really available in our Swayam platform. This is a really amazing course to look into, because even before you have a curiosity about something in the technology, they say everything you want to know about blockchain. So look into it, and after you learn it, you will itself know where you have to go next. So follow the route, follow the flow.
Thank you, Vishal. And here is your next question. What type of algorithms can be followed
Sharmila, can I have the question again? The question was not.
Vishal, can you able to hear me? Hello, Vishal?
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Do you want me to repeat the question again? Hello, Vishal?
Yes, ma'am. Can you hear me?
Ma'am, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Do you want me to repeat the question again?
Yes, ma'am.
What type of algorithms can be followed through cryptography in blockchain?
There is no set algorithms that has to be exactly learned, but every kind of crypto, this is a field you've seen in my slides, right? Like this technology just evolved from its first version to its third version within a decade, and it's totally different from how it evolved from Bitcoin to US. What I'm coming to say is Bitcoin had SHA-256 algorithm, and that was different, and Ethereum had some other algorithm called ETHhash, and US has its own algorithm. So you'll have to look into what you really want, and according to it, you should learn the algorithms.
Thank you, Vishal.
Another one question came from Rohit. Is it able to modify the data once written in the blockchain?
Till the second generation, I'm not really sure, because I have not worked on the third generation of blockchains, that is the EOS system. But I worked on the second generation, that is Ethereum. That once we deploy the blockchain or the database into a blockchain, it's not possible to do anything to it. You can't tamper the data. Even you won't have the utmost control of the data. So the third generation had the advantage of upgrading it and recovering it. But since I didn't work on it, I can't say it very clearly. But till the second generation, we can't tamper the data or we can't upgrade it.
Here is your next question. How digital signature differs from hashing in blockchain? Can I repeat it? How digital signature differs from hashing in blockchain?
Actually, hash is a digital signature of data that is put into a block. But can the person who questioned it, can you differentiate what digital signature is from a hash? Because a block's digital signature is its own hash. Like I've shown you in the demo, we put in the data, whatever the data it may be, the hash that is provided by the specific algorithm is the digital signature of that data. Can you please differentiate both, the person who has asked the question?
Actually, Vishal, the question is how it has been differentiated, like through cryptocurrency payments, we'll be having we need the digital signature, right? So how it is changed or different from the security technique that is hashing?
Actually, they are not different, ma'am. If the data is put into a block and the data digital signature is the hash that is being mined of that block. So they are not different.
Okay.
If you have any queries, kindly post it up in the chat box. Okay, we'll end this Q&A session. And now, I wholeheartedly invite Mr. S. Sampat Kumar, Assistant Professor CRC, to deliver a vote of thanks.
Okay, my dear students, hope I'm audible. Thank you very much, Sharmila. Okay, thank you very much, Sharmila. Okay, thank you very much for your wonderful presentation, Mr. Vishal. Your presentation gave us a good understanding about basics of blockchain. Thank you, Vishal. Till now, most of us think that cryptocurrency or sorry, this blockchain is meant only for cryptocurrency.
Okay.
Your presentation breaks all those things. Okay. You gave us, and most of us think that we people are not into blockchain yet. Okay, your presentation breaks it, and you clearly says that we are already using blockchain. Okay, without our knowledge, we are already using blockchain, and also the learning resource which you have shown. Okay, it is also a good learning resource. It's a very interesting learning resource. Actually, I also took that course. Okay, apart from that, there are few other courses in Coursera. Okay, and I think you people, most of you people know that Coursera is giving this few courses for free of cost. Okay, you can also enroll these courses. There are many courses in Coursera. It's a very good courses available in Coursera. Starting from the very basics of blockchain to advanced blockchain, there is courses available in Coursera. You can enroll to that courses. Okay, that's about presentation and about viewers. Thank you very much for viewing our presentation, my dear viewers. And in a short while, we will share you the PPT and today's recording. And don't forget to fill the feedback form. And tomorrow we have a presentation about quantum computing by Mr. Ajay Desigan and Mr. Gokul from third year CSEA. And once again, thank you all for joining this wonderful presentation. Meet you tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Vishal.
Sir, I would like to extend this thanks to all the teachers and students who have been motivating me for last 3 days.
Sure. I also thank my team, okay, faculty members of CSE department, HOD ma'am and principal for motivating us to conduct this wonderful presentation, wonderful webinar. Okay, thank you all. Thank you very much for joining us. And the feedback form will be shared to you in.
Sir, already shared in chat.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. It is already shared. Please fill the feedback form to get the today's webinar certificate. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much for joining us.